Happy Sabbath. Thank you. Need to put our hand in the hand. Isn't that right? Never let go. If you got a hand of the Savior this morning, keep your hand right there. We welcome everybody. We're glad you're here. Happy Sabbath. Those at home, encourage you to, keep your hand right there in the hand of Jesus Christ. Can never go wrong, right? When you got your hand in the hand, that means you're not going to get too far ahead. You're not going to get there far behind. You're going to walk side by side. And that's what He wants us to do. Let Jesus lead in your heart and in your life today. Well, again, I'm very grateful and thankful for another Sabbath day, aren't you? And we can come together. As we see the world winding down and the nearness to the coming of Jesus, I believe this is what the subject that we are looking at today, that a couple of weeks ago that we started, and then the big storm came and no power last week and so on and so forth. But it's very, very important subject that we need to look. Proper Sabbath observance. As Seventh-day Adventist Christians, we say, well, we keep the fourth commandment. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And so then we take it from there and say, well, we just keep it, but yet is it possible that we can profess to keep God's all ten commandments or the fourth commandment and somehow be breaking it? Is it possible? Are there proper things that we should do on the Sabbath and things that are improper to do on Sabbath? This is what we need to look at in the light of the Bible. Because if we're thinking that we're keeping it and pleasing to God, and yet we are not, and we're breaking it, we still are a lawbreaker. You know? There's no excuse for those of us who have taken a positional stance of keeping the seventh-day Sabbath, of really not knowing what we should do and what we shouldn't do on the Sabbath. It makes a difference to God. If it makes a difference to God, then it makes a difference to me. How about you? It's not what man thinks. It's not some rules that man have thrown out. But it's what God says is proper to do on His day. If we do those things that are improper, then it cannot be pleasing to Him. And we all want to please God. So it's a reminder probably for some of you, and maybe it might be some, God will shine some extra light on all of us as we study together. So the subject part two, the question of proper Sabbath observance. Now, with this said, I want to look up three or four quick passages of Scripture, because proper Sabbath observance will mean nothing to you or to me if we will not observe these little simple Bible passages. First, put them in our hearts and in our mind and be willing, and then all of a sudden, the rest of God's Word takes its proper place. Those at home, be sure to get your Bible and look these passages up with us. 2 Corinthians, the New Testament. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. Notice what the Bible says. See if it makes sense to you today. It makes a lot of sense to me. And especially the first line, I've kind of colored it in my Bible so that it would jump out at me as I read this passage. You ever do that in Scripture? It's good to underline. Some people say, oh, I never underline my Bible. I like to mark my Bible up. For those of you maybe who aren't sure, I like to mark it up. And then I can remember sometimes the markings better than I can maybe what the words even said, but I can remember where it's found, what it looks like on the page. It helps. The Bible says, now then what? We are ambassadors for Christ. What a heavy responsibility. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead. Be ye what? Reconciled to God. Notice how it starts out. Number one, the Bible says, now we are what? We are His ambassadors. Right? We are standing, as it were, in His place. He has sent us in His place. We are to represent Him to the world. That, you know, you see that in a lot of businesses. You see it in the government, don't you, a lot? We have an ambassador to what? Another country. That person goes ambassador to represent what? United States of America. Jesus looks at me and you, and He says, you are my ambassador. Well, wouldn't it be nice if we represented Jesus Christ rather than ourselves? This is what it's all about, of being in it. Now, if we don't represent Jesus, then we cannot be His ambassador. And this is part of the principle that we're building on today about proper Sabbath observance. If we claim to be His, then we must follow in His what? In His footsteps, we will see that. Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10, verse 37. This is a very simple passage of Scripture, but again, If you don't realize that you're an ambassador, then you may want to keep the Sabbath any way that you feel that you need to or you want to, rather than what the Word says. Matthew chapter 10, I'm going to look up verse 37. Matthew 10, 37. You've read this many times, but let it fit this morning, shall we? Verse 37, what does the Bible say? Read it with me. He that loveth what? Father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He that loveth son or daughter more than me is not what? Worthy of me. I want you to see this morning once again the passage of Scripture here. If they're not important, if they're not put in the right position in our relationship with Christ, proper Sabbath observance won't make any difference to us. First of all, it says there that we are His ambassadors, so we're representing Him, so we have to walk the way He walked. But if we love somebody else, mom, dad, brother, sister, job, doesn't matter what, more than we love Christ, we're not going to worry about keeping His commandments, are we? Not if we love things more than we love Him. So we have to say here, I love Jesus more than anything in the world. I have to put Him first, right, in everything. And all these other things, the Bible says, will be what? Added unto you. In the New Testament, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 20. Let's look up another quick passage. See if it gels with us this morning. I think it does as we look up Scripture here. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 10. Ephesians 5, verse 10. Very simple. The Bible says, read with me when you have it. It says, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. So today, from Scripture, we're going to be doing what? Proving what is acceptable to God. Now, if we just keep going over these things, I hope they make more sense. What was the first criteria, first principle that we're talking about? We must recognize, in order for God's seventh-day Sabbath to be important in our life, that we are, number one, His what? His ambassador. Number two, we must love God what? More than anything else in the world. Because if we love Him, we want to serve Him, right? If He has something special for us, we want that thing, right? Something special in store for us. And then the way that we do it from Scripture, the Bible just said, we just read it, that we have to prove what? What is acceptable unto God. So the seventh-day Sabbath, okay, I keep it. But do we do it accept what is acceptable to God or acceptable to ourselves and our lifestyle? Think about it. Remember, there are things that are acceptable, things that are not acceptable to God. And believe it or not, dear friends, we become commandment breakers if we know better. Okay, well, it doesn't matter. I know I can do this here. Or, well, I'm out doing... I hear a lot of people, well, I went to do this and that because this... Friend, nothing takes the place of church service. Do you get that? You know, because people will say, well, I went out and did some good. You know what? You can do some good in the afternoon after services too, if it's acceptable to God. You follow me? You don't miss church services in order to, well, I'll do something. Unless it's emergency, life and death, you understand that. Balance it up. I heard one man say last week, boy, there's a horrible mess. People were hemmed in. They couldn't get out of their house because these big trees were over the road. And he is a good Sabbath observer. But he said they couldn't get out and they needed some help. I took my chainsaw and I sawed that tree so they could get out because it was important they get out to get some food and some water. Amen. Think about that. I didn't say he missed church to do it. I just said he went out to help a neighbor who was in dire need to get out and couldn't. I want you to just kind of weigh these things before we really attack them through Bible and spirit of prophecy, because we must prove what is acceptable unto whom? And God. And remember, not ourself. The biggest battle I have is self. Self wants to do, right, some other things, and we end up being very good justifiers. Are you with me? We do things and then we justify why we did it rather than the Bible says yes or the Bible says no. And this is what we have to gauge it by. One more, Matthew chapter 22. Matthew chapter 22. Now again, what happens if we don't put these into operation, these passages of Scripture, what we will be talking about will mean nothing to you or to me. Matthew chapter 22, verses 37 and 38. This is what it boils down to in loving Jesus with all of your hearts, what the Bible said, verse 37. Are you ready? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt what? love the Lord thy God with how much? All your heart and all your soul and all your mind. This is what? The first and great commandment. It didn't say the second. It didn't say the last. It said this is what? The first and the great. Because all the others will mean what? They won't mean anything to you, to me, unless we love God, right, with all of our heart. If you love Him with all your heart, then you want to do again that which pleases Him. I hope these little things just make some sense to you as we study. We read from Nehemiah 8:8 for those who were not here last week. I'm not going to spend much time on that. Those at home, you're taking notes, you need to look these passages up. Nehemiah 8:8, it just simply says that at that time they opened up the book of the law. Do you remember it? And they read out of the book of the law, and it said all understood. My desire is that we all understand. To read out the book and not to understand it, you see, is not the plan that God has for us. Because He said if any of us lack wisdom, right, or understanding, we can come to God and ask. Do you pray about that before you come to church? See, do I pray about it? I pray about having wisdom in spiritual matters. I don't know about you. I think it's okay to do that. How about you? I want to have wisdom, and I tell God that, and it's okay, and God understands. I say, I don't want wisdom in things of the world because I don't want it. But I want wisdom in spiritual things to help me see that which I need to see for my life and then to help somebody else maybe in their walk with Jesus. So it's very, very important as we look at these things here that when they opened the book of the law, by the way, we talked about it before, they opened the book of the law and said the people had such reverence for the law that they came to their feet. And they read it when the sun came up until after dinner time. And the people loved it. I said, here, you go past your little time flight. You have people, oh, man. You know, we can't hit an hour time. Oh, a long-winded preacher. And the sun came up so they could see. You read the book of Nehemiah chapter 8, the whole thing, you see. But it said also, as they read these passages, as the preacher got up, he read to all the people, it says they begin to weep. Because I think it brought, number one, conviction on their heart. Of what was read there, they weren't doing the right thing. But then the priest come by and said, hey, don't be weep. This is a happy time. Amen. Something about reading about God and doing what He would have us to do should make us happy. Amen. And that's dealing with the Sabbath hours to be happy rather than a curse or rather as a restriction that I can't do what I do 6 days. Some of us look at that. I had a little problem with it growing up because I loved to play basketball so much that I told you before, I wanted to shoot the devil just kept saying, can he get the ball and shoot one? Your mom's not looking. That basketball looked so inviting. And I thought, you know, I can shoot that ball real quick. And of course, if I made one, I was compelled to try to make another one. Are you still with me? Some of you don't play, you have no idea what I'm talking about, but still don't go to sleep. We weren't allowed. I could play basketball 6 days. But on the Sabbath in our home, we never played basketball. I don't know about you, but it's kind of difficult. You can play basketball or a game, and you can be a representative of Jesus Christ if you conduct yourself as such. Or you can be like the devil. Are you still with me? And sometimes, you know, we play basketball all the time. You know, I get pretty ferocious when I used to play basketball. So I'm not sure I represented him all the time. And I tell you one thing, my mind, I'm just food for thought. My mind wasn't on the Sabbath, if I'd gotten to a basketball game, it was on winning or taking out the opponent. Somebody with me. So my mother knew that, and my dad did too. And so I just keep these things kind of in your mind, the things that maybe you wanted to do. But that basketball kept saying, Kenny, come on over here and shoot me. Come on over here. I'm lonesome. Somebody's not with me. And so it was good that the basketball was put out of my sight. Somebody's not with me. Because it was calling me. Other things may be calling you, and sometimes it's good to put things out of sight. Keep all this in mind because we'll re-examine a lot of these things. But just in your own life, what calls you to do those things that maybe we shouldn't be doing on God's time? Okay? On God's time. We read in 2 Peter, or 1 Peter 2, you remember? That Christ set an example for us, right? That we should walk. We looked up some words and we found out that he left us you remember this word? Carbon what? A carbon copy. We talked about getting the ink on our fingers and all that, you know. He left a carbon copy so I wouldn't make any mistake. And so if I walk the way he walked, I can be assured it's okay, right? And then we read Malachi 3:6. He said, I am God, what? I change not. So we can be assured. We read in Luke 4:16, as his custom was, he went in the sanctuary on the Sabbath day and stood up for it to read. This is what your Savior did. This is what he advocated. This is the example that he left. But the world is fighting the example of Jesus Christ today, aren't they? They're following the example of man rather than Jesus Christ. He said we have to love him with all of our heart, our soul, and our mind. Love him more than anything. And so I'm challenged. This may be the more bigger challenge for Adventist Christians than any of the other commandments. Did you know that? Because we think we have it, we think we understand it, we think that we do, but yet we've got self to fight with. A struggle. If I had something going on Saturday night, as many times I'd run out of the house and look for the sun. Is that really pleasing in the sight of God? Just think about these things. If God made something special for me, but I couldn't wait for it to set, was I really observing it the right way? Did I have the right thoughts about it at that time growing up? Use your mind. Was I hurrying it along and didn't care? Wished it was down so I could go about my activities. What did I love more? We read in 1 John, if you remember 2 verse 6, that if we say we abide in him, isn't that right? Then we ought to walk as what? As he walked. I promised you a little journey, if you'll remember. Well, bless your hearts, you know, it's hard enough to remember 1 week, let alone two, right? We promised us a little journey, didn't we? We're going to take a little bit. Into the life of the Israelites. Oh, thank you, Lord. Okay, we got somebody that's paid attention. All right. Because we want to see. Now, this was quite a few years ago, how the typical Jew would welcome in the Sabbath hours. This is what they would do in their home. Maybe not so much more nowadays. But where did they get this thinking? Why did they do some of these things? Did they get them from Scripture or did they do from tradition? Because we have problems, or we have had problems, that, you know, Jesus had to come and he came to his own because they were putting too many rules and things right into operation. They were confusing the mind about all kind of doctrine and teaching, not just the Sabbath. And Jesus came to set the record straight and to show them what real true Sabbath observance was all about, because they put so many restrictions. You could only walk, you could only have so many steps, you could only do. And for every restriction they had, the Jews made something else where it'd give them more freedom to do something, right? Like you could only take so many steps, you remember, on the Sabbath? You know? And that was it. Well, you get out here and you say, wish that sun would go down. And I guarantee you there were many that got caught outside somewhere not thinking, and all of a sudden they got caught and they probably stood for hours thinking they were pleasing God. Not dare take another step, I've already. Then they found out that, you know, as long as you, what, from your home, wasn't it? And so what they would do, they say, you know, I'm going on a longer journey. I've only have so many steps I could do. So they'd take a loaf of bread, and Friday they'd run way over here and they'd put it underneath a tree. And so, so many steps will get me to the tree. This is my house. Now I get to go that many steps again. Somebody still with me? That's a religion I'm not interested in. I'm going to be very frank with you. At all. But I know that somehow I have to be able to balance what I do on the Sabbath day. Whether it's traveling unnecessarily, you know, whether it's some kind of work that doesn't need to be done or whatever on God's day. Because remember, we read last week that the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. The seventh day, one seventh of the week, belongs to God, not you, not me. And he says, come apart and be separate. Come apart from the world, because you're going to need this time, you see, to replenish what the devil is trying to chisel away during those 6 days. You know that. Some of you have been in the world a longer time. You understand what the devil does. Tries to weaken us down. God has called his people in the last days to do what? Lift up a standard. And our point we must remember today is the Sabbath will be the big issue in the last closing scenes of Earth's history. Are you still with me? The final conflict that everyone is going to play a part in. And so it behooves us to know what pleases God and what doesn't please God. I like to think in terms of, if you allow me today, the Sabbath. I like to talk about the Sabbath of Jesus Christ. Not my Sabbath, not a denomination Sabbath, but it was the Sabbath of Jesus. It makes it so much easier for some people maybe to swallow. It was the Sabbath. It is the Sabbath of Jesus. Oh, it's the Sabbath of the Jews. It's the Sabbath of Seventh-day Adventists, Seventh-day Baptists, Seventh-day Church of God. Seventh day is the Lord's day. It's His day. And since it is, and He created it for man, that surely He would have some things that He would try to help us. This is what would please me if you will do these things. Then you won't be sidetracked. You won't get off balanced. You'll keep your mind me, right, on God. So you have no other gods before Him. 1 Samuel 2:30, Bible says, them that honor me, what? I will honor. So today, if you're willing to honor God, God said, I'm going to honor you. He says, I'll cause you to ride on the high places of the earth. Isn't that right? Even though our roof blows off, God's still in control. Amen. Even though houses were smashed and maybe lives lost, God is still in control. Even though the bank account may not be like it should be, and maybe people have lost a lot, you know, a lot of it has to do with decisions and choices we make too, by the way. And because we make those decisions and choices, you see, God honors those things. Not what's best for us sometimes, but He allows us to do, right, to choose. Sister Anita mentioned a while ago, maybe I shouldn't use her name, Sister Anita, a while ago, that I'm thinking about moving. As long as God says for you to move. That's my personal opinion. See, you don't want to move. You don't want to do anything unless you're sure that this is what God wants. It's not what, I'm being personal, not trying to be bold. It's not what your son wants. It's not what your son needs. He's a grown man. Let him get it on. Are you following me? Should be taking care of you, by the way. And that's not trying to pick. It's just things coming in my mind. Is if I'm going to be here, I need to be because God wants me here. Because if it's not, then that means I'm not in the will of God. I'm not where He wants me to be. And other things will become more difficult for me. Number one, it's going to be going away from this church. And when the gas price goes back up again, I'll be having calls. I can't make it this week because I... Don't you wish it was somebody else that said something today, isn't that right? Well, she knows we love. We're not trying to pick on, just give good food for thought, because it's for every one of us. In the job that you do, wherever you're at, we're ambassadors, and we need to be where God wants us to be. That's why we're still here, by the way. We still feel it's where God wants us to be at the time. If it's not, I don't want to be here anymore, because it'll be a total disaster. Think about it. If you're not where God would have you to be right now, friend, think about it. Your life's not what it should be. He has greater things involved. And so we find, as we come back to the Sabbath observance type thing, as we begin to walk through it a little bit, we're going to take the typical Jewish house of many years ago and what they did. And because they have a lot of the burdens we talked about a while ago, we understand those things. But let's just kind of look beyond that and see if any of this makes sense to you. We can take a short trip. We can do it to the temple if you want, or we can do it into their house in preparation. Now, as you see what they're doing, try to think in Scripture of where they might have gotten this idea. Or did they just write it out and say, this is what we want to do? If they did it then and they were close to God and maybe close to Scripture and took it from Scripture, maybe it might be something we might want to think about. What did it deal with? Maybe give us some food for thought. Maybe. Maybe some folks, maybe it won't. But I pray that it makes us think. But I knew this from reading and studying on this here, that the Sabbath hours for the typical Jew years ago was a very cheerful, happy time. They were happy to see the Sabbath come. Now, that'd be the first point we might look at today. Is it really, when the Sabbath hours are coming on us, are we getting happy about it, or are we saying, oh, brother, oh, I have to put this up, I can't do this anymore? Maybe our attitudes are not what they ought to be. Think about it. If ever we ever say, oh no, the Sabbath is coming, how sad. You know what we're saying? Oh no, God is coming. God's day is coming. Oh no, the day that God blessed and sanctified and set apart for holy use and to commune with me and to be with me. Oh no. We're rejecting Him. Do you see it? Rejecting what He has established to help save me from myself. Because there wasn't a Sabbath in my life, I would be a guy that would be working 7 days a week. I don't know about you. Doing something. Are you with me? I'd be on it. And the body wasn't meant to do that. God said, I created you, and you need to have one day that's set apart, that's different than the other 6 days. And I can help refresh you physically, spiritually, mentally. And I believe this even financially. I'm not talking about making money on Sabbath. I'm saying if you honor God, He'll make sure that your needs are met. Hope somebody's still thinking along with me now. I thought about Israel and I thought about the Jews and I'm thinking about us as Seventh-day Adventists today. And I keep thinking about, you know, as we walk through life, if we're really studying Scripture, if we're really trying to find God, will we be able to find Him? Will we really be able to find God if we're looking for Him? How do we know that? How do we really know that if we're really looking for God that we'll be able to find Him? Does the Bible tell you that? Yeah. And we're going to find the way to God. We're going to find the way that pleases God. The atmosphere of the home and the atmosphere of the church was probably very, it was a very happy occasion for the Jew. Is it happy in your home? Is it happy in the church? Lights were lit up. Think about that. Lights were lit up. Why were the lights lit up? Think about it. Did it bring happiness and cheer? Sometimes when you go down the road, the world has a lot of lights out there. Do you ever notice that? And sometimes that brings us to, you know, it gets our attention, does it not? And we want to see what's going on. Jesus said, I am the what? In John, I'm the light of the world. You are my what? My witnesses. And when there's lights and things, it reminds you of a feeling of you're happy. You're cheerful. You're excited about things. Friend, how desperately we need to be excited about the Word of God today. How is it when we meet with God? In Exodus chapter 19, we won't read all that today, just take it home with you. That Israel in Mount Sinai, what happened to them? Do you remember as God was coming down, you know, the mountain was engulfed with fire. Isn't that right? Cleansing, power. And He told Israel, you're going to meet with me in a special way. Isn't that right? What did He tell them to do? Do you remember? He basically, let's paraphrase, clean up. He said, take your clothes off, wash those clothes, and put on the very best you have because I'm coming down to meet with you. Doesn't mean, you know, people have uniforms. God requires the best that you and I have when we come into His presence. It may not be as what somebody else has, it doesn't matter, but is it the best that you have? And is it clean? God said, I'm coming in your presence now. I want you to be washed and clean inside and out, right? Prepared to receive me. In fact, as a general, I guess, rule for the Jew of years ago, the Sabbath, I think the Sabbath actually began really more on Thursday, the preparation for it. They did the majority of their shopping, did you know that? On Thursday. They were so looking forward to the Sabbath hours that they wanted all stuff put aside, everything done, so they could enjoy time with one another and with God. And so they begin to do some shopping. But on Friday, the real process begins. People say, well, why Friday? What is Friday? Well, you know from Scripture, but let's just read it for those maybe who don't. Turn with me to the book of Luke, if you'll do that, please. The book of Luke. Luke chapter 23, see what the Bible says. Luke chapter 23. I'm going to read verse 54 and 56 verses. Okay? Now remember, we said on Friday, Thursday they began to prepare and they went maybe a longer distance to get things because Sabbath was coming on. People say, yeah, but we don't know which day is Sabbath. We don't know about what preparation is. We don't know. The Bible is very, very clear on it, verse 54 of Luke chapter 23. It says, and that day was what?
Preparation.
The preparation and the Sabbath did what? Drew on. So we're talking what day here? Preparation. Yeah, the sixth day. Friday, wasn't it? Friday is preparation day. Preparation for what? For the Sabbath. Do you realize what? Friday is all designated that God has done so that we can be prepared to welcome Him in. That we don't have, well, I should have got this done. I should have had the laundry done. Oh, we didn't buy food. Oh, we don't have gas for our car. God said, all that you know, what you have need of on the Sabbath. You get that done before. The Bible says there, the preparation day, Sabbath drew on. Verse 56, what does the Bible say? It says they returned and prepared spices and ointments, and what did they do? They rested the Sabbath day. So you have Friday is the sixth day, so we know for sure that Sabbath is what? The seventh day, because it said Sabbath day, right? And they rested the Sabbath. Next day, the Sabbath, the seventh day of the week, they rested according to the commandment. Preparation day. How many of us are really using Friday as a preparation day? Are we really preparing like we should? You're right there in Luke already. How about Luke 24, verse 1? Luke 24, verse 1, it says, now upon the first day of what? The week, very early in the morning, they came to the sepulchre, bringing spices they had prepared and certain others with him. And what they found? Stone was rolled away. Jesus had risen. So we know Friday preparation. Sabbath is the seventh day of the week, right? Right? He rested in the tomb according to commandment. He rose on the first day of the week. So preparation then is very, very important. And getting ready for the Sabbath. It's very sad sometime on Sabbath morning we get up and we decide that our shirt is not clean or our shoes are not clean and we didn't get this prepared. It's called lack of preparation. I can remember as a young child we first began to grow up that mom made sure our shoes and our clothes Sabbath were all set out on Friday evening. That way there was no arguing, no fussing as Danny or maybe Ronnie or my brother. That's my shirt. Those are my socks. No arguing. Everybody had everything in order so that we would not be any, right, confusion, no fussing. You know what fussing can do on the Sabbath before you come to church? It messes up your whole day. Just being different, having a different opinion sometimes, expressing, it can mess up your whole spiritual day. And so the most things you have ready to go, so you don't have to spend 2 hours in the closet trying to figure out, what am I, when you could be spending other time on something more valuable. So it's just a gut. That's called what? Preparation. For those who getting married, do you just wait till the day you get married and start looking for a dress? Huh? Ooh, what shoes am I wearing? What kind of flowers are we going to? You've done what? You've prepared for those things. It makes sense, doesn't it? Fellowship lunch. Hopefully Ashley's not going to show up today and say, well, what are we going to have? We're in trouble. Because they've been preparing, hopefully. Your Sabbath school teacher gets up here and says, well, let's see, what are we going to study today? I don't know, what are we? Preparation. All during the week, isn't that right? So when we come together, we're ready to spend time with Jesus and to learn more about Him. Preparation day. Preparation day was Friday, the Bible said. Preparing for what? The seventh day Sabbath. Didn't say the first day. It said the Sabbath day, isn't that right? So Friday is for the Jew, by the way, was an early day. They got up early because there was a lot of things that they needed to do. There was much cooking to be done. They want to make sure that their cooking was all pretty much all done so that they didn't have to spend long hours in the kitchen or long hours of preparation because it was hours away from God. It was hours getting things. You say, well, cooking's not bad if it takes you away from God and time with Him. Time with study, time that He wants you to be doing other things. That's why He said preparation day. So on Friday, you see, all the housework was done in the Jewish home. Are you still with me? Where did they get all these thoughts? The housework was done. Everything was put into its place. Special bread sometime was made. Special Sabbath food was made. They wanted the young people to look forward to it. Mama would make special dish for the Sabbath. Ooh, good, the Sabbath. Mom's making something special. It's not like all the other days. It's a special day. And we're going to wear special clothes on that day. It's different than any other day, the youth would say. This is what we want to do. Special Sabbath food prepared. Yum, yum. All this done on Friday. Because, by the way, to the Jew at that point in time, cooking wasn't permissible on the Sabbath. So if you wanted to eat, you'd prepare it. Now think a principle with me today, dear friends. I think the principle still applies. How about you? Especially, you know, olden time when you had to go out and get something, right, and get rid of it, you know, and get it all ready to go. It took your whole day. It was no different than the other 6 days. God said, I want this to be different. Prepare for Friday. Have everything laid out in order and decent. You can spend more time together with me. Too much time. So the house was spick and span. Clean. So the mother wouldn't have to look around and say, oh, what a mess over here. Oh, the children, what a mess over here. Oh, this wasn't done. It just ruins the special day. Everything was nice, neat, and done on Friday. Because if we didn't, it'd take too much time away from God if we did it on Sabbath. It'd take our minds away, our hearts away. And, you know, if we did, our sweeper would break down. And then we're, upset because the sweeper broke down. You know what, you follow what I'm saying? You know, the iron, this would break, or the washing machine would break. All these things, if we did those things, we'd be torn up on that day. God says, don't do those things. I don't want you torn up. I want it special. So Friday evening, before the sun set, everything was done that needed to be done for the Sabbath. Awesome. All things, listen carefully, everything that pertained to their work that they did during those 6 days was put out of sight. Remember me talking about the basketball kept calling me? So all of those things, you see, were put out of sight. Anything that would remind them of what they may need to do on Sunday, are you with me, or Monday, put them out of sight. Because that's not what the Sabbath is for, to remind you about work that you've got 6 days to do. So whatever those things might be to them, may I get a little more personal and up where we are today in history, we might say today that for the Sabbath hours, as the sun sets, that we turn the television off. Because all the TV does is things of the world. Even the news, it'll be there the next day. You follow me? And you'll get an update, be fresh. You still with me? So we turn that off because you can't concentrate on God. You can't read the Bible. You can't be studying. You can't be witnessing. Can't be giving a Bible study with that thing on. Think about it. And after all, it reminds me of the world and the things that's going on in the world. And the Bible says that's enmity against God. You see how you could be sidetracked? I can. If I'm watching this over here for 2 hours, I have no idea what day it is. And so you have to turn it off. You don't need it in your world on that day. It's God's day. And so you simply turn it off. You turn the radio off. You don't need to be listening to who went out with who on the Sabbath. Who did somebody wrong on the Sabbath. Is somebody still there? There's enough of that during the 6 days. You follow me? I need to be hearing about the goodness and the glory of God. I don't know about you. And may I be a little more personal. On the Sabbath day, we need to be very careful about our phones. Because most generally, it's phone calls on Friday evening and things, people got something, they're selling something. Right? They're needing something. They're things of the world that's brought into right your day that you should be spending with God and not, you know, people. Things. Even, how are you doing? I tell you, I was down at the mall the other day. You don't need to hear about the mall on the Sabbath. Are you still with me? You can do that on Sunday. I want you to really think about me. All this does, remember, is pull us away from God. We're inviting the world and trying to have it take the place of God's day when God says that's not acceptable. Now, you can do what you want. We said today, people are adults. You can do what you want. But do you want to please God or please yourself? See, this is what I battle. Do I want to please what God says? He says if I'm watching TV, right, it's taking my time that I could be doing something for His day, His honor, His glory. If I'm reading the newspaper, what is in the newspaper? Is there things about God? Is it going to transform my life and change my heart and prepare me to meet? Huh? What did Jesus do on the Sabbath? These are things that might be able to help us. You think they didn't have some kind of printouts or some kind of something that He could have read or done some other things if He had wanted to? Sure. He didn't do those things. Because it takes our mind and heart away from what? Him. He said, I need what? I need your mind. I need your soul. everything, right? That's the whole total sum. He needs us so that we're not sidetracked. So we may have to pick our phone. You have to screen. You have to take that phone, screen that call. I bring it, you know, to church with me and I turn it off, put it in my desk drawer. You know why? That's where it's going to stay off. Think about it. Church is not a place for it, for outside anything to come in other than if it's spiritual. See? I might turn it on after church and whatever, but you know what? I'll look at it. They got caller ID on them, that right? So, you know, if church members or somebody that I think, you know, maybe has, I'll answer the phone. If it's not, I don't deal with it, period. Because I don't need any of the world. I don't need the things that I get every day bombarded with there in the world. It takes my mind away from it. Aggravates me sometimes. How about you? Get calls at 9, 9:30 at night. Oh, I'm your local son. We need you to... What? We see you have a Sears chainsaw here and we want to renew your contract. What? Renewing no contract with me at 9, 9:30 at night? Somebody's not with me. And definitely you don't need it on the Sabbath. Are you still with me? See, Sears called me on Sabbath. Don't answer the phone. You do God's business, not Sears' business. And we may have to take our computers and turn them off unless we're looking for something that's spiritual. If it's talking to somebody else that's not spiritual, not spiritual matter, it's not pleasing to God. This is getting heavy duty, you follow me, getting personal. But it's really not. And we'll read some Bible passages, you see, that will clarify exactly what I'm saying, plus spirit of prophecy. I'm not just making this up. So we got people in Adventism say about work on Sabbath. You know, hospitals, they'll say. Well, I work in a hospital on Sabbath. I've got a word in due season for a lot of people, too. And it comes from Scripture, it comes from spirit of prophecy. But just be people all upset. But mine is, do we want to please God or not? Regardless if Loma Linda does it or not, or some of these other hospitals or not, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's right. It doesn't mean they're wrong either. It simply says, I'm going to weigh it with what? We said we had to prove all things by what? By Scripture. You remember reading that? Everything we do, we have to prove. And then when we read and prove, and we will from Scripture, where it talks about here that we're never to have anything that increases our wallet or our billfold on the Sabbath day. There's some things we may end up doing or whatever that's for good or somebody, but you're never to increase. You're never to have right increase for work on the Sabbath, even if it's in the hospital, even if it's a doctor. Man, it's heavy duty. But you can always, if you have to do that because a surgeon may have to go in and do surgery on somebody on the Sabbath, whatever, emergency type thing, he can always take that money and he does what? He gives it to God because it's God's money. It's not his. No personal gain on the Sabbath day. Now, I can read more of that stuff later if you want to do that. I think we probably should, because some of the people will be shocked and they get aggravated and they'll send some letters and say, oh, I can't believe. Listen, you need to be reading and I need to be reading and studying. Because if it's true and if it's right, we want to do it. We really do. God makes provisions for us that we can do things, except, you know, emergency we're talking about. So we have the folks here, and they're observing the Sabbath. How wonderful that is. And we find out, you know, well, we had to put some things up. Some people say Friday night. You remember this Friday? Well, why Friday night? Leviticus 23, isn't it? What does it say? It said, from evening till evening shall you do what? Celebrate what? Leviticus 23:32 says, from even to even shall you celebrate your Sabbaths. So when the sun goes down Friday evening, that's God's time when the sun goes down. And people, I tell you, we have people all the time, they come in, well, I can't understand. Well, in the round world where we're in right now, the sun's going down 2 hours later in California. Is there? I say, where are you at? I'm in West Frankfort. I said, that's all you're accountable for. You don't live in California. Don't worry about what the Californians are doing. Somebody's not with me. Is that what we're challenged with, is what they're doing there? No. Where you're at right now is all that God requires of me. If it did, I'd be a nervous wreck right now. I wouldn't know what to do, would you? Well, they're just getting up over here in China. Well, they're going to bed over here in Russia. I don't know what they're doing. I tell you, I go out of my mind. But we serve a God that's fair and just. Are you still with me? And he says, Kenny, just where you're at is all you're accountable for, son. Oh, man. Friday evening, everything is ready. We only have 10 minutes or so. Friday evening, everything is ready for the Sabbath hours. Oh, man. You know what? The baths were all taken. You with me? You realize what a commotion it can be? I'm sure for my uncle Olin, when he had 12 kids running around in one bathroom and one bathtub. You think there wasn't knocking and banging and thumping maybe going on. Everybody upset because they should have it. And the majority of them were girls. They need more time. Somebody still with me? You ever go out to their house on a Friday evening before sundown, you're going to find those kids, those girls, they're going to take their baths. Do you know that? They were preparing for the Sabbath because they couldn't take the commotion on the Sabbath hours. They didn't have time. They were in preparation. The Jewish family years ago, that's what they did. Mother would step up to the plate, as it were, on the Sabbath hours. Mother would be the one that would go around the house, and she would light special little candles and things down there, and the children would start to get happy. Oh, good, it's the Sabbath hours are beginning. Mama's lighting the candles. And saying, oh, turn the TV off. Oh, no. Turn the computer off. Oh, I can't live without it. Oh, I've got to have IV. You know, we think of that with our cell phone. IV. Somebody's not with me. It's almost that way. You turn it off. Oh, no, I can't live without it. Can't live without the world, the things that are in the world. Yeah. I'm telling you, we've got some we're challenged with some issues as God's last day people. And remember, if the world is doing it, we don't want to do it. It's automatically wrong. Do you get it? Because the world is enmity against God. That's what it says in James. And so mother lights all these candles and the kids are starting to get happy. Light symbolized for the Jew, and I want it to symbolize there. It symbolized joy. Are you still with me? It symbolized goodness, and it symbolized cheer. So what? The Sabbath hours, the sun was setting, mom started to light the candles in the house, everybody got happy. Woo, this is good. We're to be happy on this day. You train a little child like this, they're to be happy when the sun goes down, they'll remain happy. It's because we let the world come in and it tears them apart. They no longer find us a joy. Because the devil has crept in with darkness rather than light. You start a child out eating green beans, they'll love green beans. You take a 3-year-old child and say, do you like these green beans? No, we don't like green beans. They'll tell you right off the rip. You want some fruit here or you want some candy? We want candy. You don't give them that choice. You start feeding them those things that's good for them when they're little and they will love it. Amen. It's when you start giving them choices when they are not capable of making the right choice at 3, 4, 5, and 6. Only choice they ever make and what you and I are still making is selfish choices. What tastes good? You see? We can't do that. And so the lights were all lit, Matthew 5:14 and 16. You know, we're that light that's set up on a hill, are we not? And in John 8:12, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. So they knew as the Sabbath hours began to be approached that God was coming down in a very special way to them. And they were happy about it. Think about it. Are we really happy when the Sabbath hours come on? And then mom would light the candles when she got done. Mom had a special coin. Did you know that? In their house, they had a little box called like a charity box. And she would light the coins and the children were happy and dad was happy. She'd take that coin and she would drop it in that box. And all would be so excited because it was a charity box. It was a box that money would be taken up to help somebody else. Do something what? Good. Oh, interesting. Do something good for what? Somebody else. As the Sabbath hours come in, we are to do something good for somebody else on the Sabbath. What God would have us to do. So good thing, charitable gifts, or doing something. Take somebody something. Are you still with me? You following all these things? So it wasn't just, well, we throw a coin in or anything. There was meaning behind it. And they learned that there's better, the Bible said, to do what? Acts chapter 20, about verse 35, it says it's better to give than to what? Than to receive. They were taught that giving was better than receiving. And that those who were in need, you see, that you'd put the sacrifice and you'd help them on the Sabbath. Wow, good. And then mother, as she finished her rounds, she would take her hand, the palm of her hand, she'd put it over her eyes. Right there. And then she would pronounce a blessing. She would have a prayer. Inviting the Spirit of God in with them. Man, that's good. What But she shielded her eyes because of the holiness of God. Isn't that right? And the sheer awesomeness of Him coming into their presence. How many of us think about it? Mother would sit down and father would get up. Oh, how impressive. Oh, the respect that the children had for the mother and father is awesome. Not like today. 5-year-old tell you how the hog ate the cabbage rather quickly. The father would get up and there'd be silence in the house. Had 3 or 4 children or 5, however it would be, around there. You know what he'd do? Father would go up and he'd take his hand and he'd lay him on each child's head. He'd thank God for that child and he'd bless that child in the name of Jesus. They were special. Special prayer for Timmy. Special prayer for Johnny, for Jane. You get it? They felt so special that the head of the house, representing God, isn't that right? Jesus. Amen. Priest of the household was pronouncing a blessing on their little old heads. They had their little heads bowed and Dad would come by and put it on there and pray. Then Dad would say a little blessing over the juice and the bread they were about to partake. It was special. Sabbath hours were on. Mom had lit the candles. Dad had had a prayer for the family. Mom did too. Now he prayed for the juice and for the bread. Oh, how excited they were. It was special. They didn't do it every day. This was special. How they wanted it. Oh, they loved it. And they took that bread. You know what happened? And they began as a family to sing. They began to sing some songs. Very unique religious songs. You know what a song will do sometime to your heart? When you're going through maybe stress and strain, you lift up your voice to Jesus. This is the symbol of it. As they ate, the bread and water would be sure. God would take care of meet their needs. And they had burdens during the week, and they had tests, and they had trials during the week, and it was almost too much for them. But as they began to sing, they forgot their burdens. They forgot their worries. They forgot their sorrows, because that's what we're to do on the Sabbath hours. We're to forget about our burdens. Well, we don't have money for this. We don't have a house payment. We're going to lose our car. God said, don't worry on the Sabbath. I'll take care of it for you. You come and realize I'm the light of the world. You realize everything in this world, I own it. And I know what you have need of before you ever ask. And just come to me. I'm gonna bless you. And they begin to sing, and their sorrows, their burden was gone. And then you know what happens? After they had that little fellowship snack, I want to call it, together, and they prayed together, and they sang songs, and they're happy. The family went to bed early on Friday night so they could get up early on Sabbath. Somebody's not with me. There were no night prowlers on Friday, a true Sabbath keeper. Do you know that? And today, you know what? I want you to take that very seriously. Do not spend late hours on Friday evening. It affects your sleep. It affects your attitude. It affects the things, by the way, that we can get involved with that maybe we shouldn't get involved with. We're prepared. We welcome in the Sabbath. And we want to make sure we get a good what? Night's rest, so that we can get up what? See, if everybody did that, you realize there would be no one late on Sabbath? A lot of times you have people, late getting here. Oh, yeah, well, I was up 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. We have to realize, I'm going to be very frank about it, that's not pleasing in the sight of God. Not at all, especially on Friday night. Because you can't be yourself. Because what happened was, you come here to church and you take a little nap. And you're doubly unpleasing to God. How's that for being point blank, okay? It is. You know what Spirit of Prophecy says? It says people, it grieves the Holy Spirit away. It says angels weep. When they behold the congregation, see somebody sleep, they weep because they're knowing they're missing the word that might save them. Are you with me? I can't hardly imagine an angel of heaven weeping, looking at it and say, don't they realize their eternal destiny? It's almost over with. And they care not. Friend, get a good night's rest on Friday. Get up early in the morning. Get here early on Sabbath. Why? Because as a Jew, welcome in the Sabbath, right? With joy and thanksgiving. I can't wait to get there. It's exciting. Oh, wow. They retire early. They get up early for the blessings of the day. You know why? They wanted to get up early because they were afraid they were going to miss a blessing. How many of us are afraid we may miss a blessing on the Sabbath? I mean, think about it. We want you to be, but a lot of people don't care. They don't think there's any more blessing on Sabbath than any other day. I disagree. I believe that God's blessing doubly on the Sabbath or more. It's His day. He said, I'm going to bless you on that day. And early Sabbath morning, all the family's up. Everything is laid out. All the food has been prepared. It's easy to get up, just get washed, put your clothes on, and we're ready to go. Oh, we can't wait. And all the family goes to church on the Sabbath. Nobody's staying home. And after the church service, you know what happens? The family once again, the family gathers together again around the table, and Father again says the blessing over the food. Now they eat leisurely. I want to get this point in before our time runs out. They eat the food on Sabbath leisurely. They're not in any hurry to, hurry up with fellowship lunch. I've got places to go. I've got to go do. Are you with me? Our people, oh, man, it's 1 o'clock. I've got to get out of here. Where are you going? What are you doing? Oh, now you're getting nosy. No, I want you to know that heaven views these things, friend. It's between you and your Heavenly Father. I'm not trying to be bold. I'm just trying to bring it to your point where you can look at it, okay? Think about it. We're in a hurry to get out of the presence of God. But you see, the Christians, the Sabbath believers in early days, they wasn't in a hurry for Sabbath to get over. They wanted to be. They ate their food Sabbath afternoon after the message, right, church? They ate it leisurely. And, oh, I tell you, and you know what they did? As they got done eating, and they were eating slowly, and they were just enjoying the presence of one another, and the presence of God was so thick around there, they so enjoyed it. And then they all began to sing. Everybody started singing around the tables, and they just said, oh, all of a sudden, joy. More joy flooded their soul to how good that God is, how they so enjoyed their self. Sabbath afternoon services were spent in different ways. It pertained to how old you might be. The older folks didn't do as much as the younger folks did. The older ones got a little more rest, possibly. The young ones, many times, would go out for walks on Sabbath afternoon. And then they would visit other families and other homes, some that were sick physically and spiritually. They might take them a loaf of bread. They'd go to the hospital, as it were. They'd visit somebody again who was sick and pray for that person. Interesting what we're to do on the Sabbath. Didn't pick up a shovel and go out and mow the grass and do all kinds of stuff at all. They were out in benefit of mankind. That's what Jesus did, exactly what He did on the Sabbath. We'll see that more as we go into this. Exactly what Jesus did. But you know, the conclusion of the Sabbath, if we close, think, the conclusion of the Sabbath is again, we call it a Vespers, or in your home, or you have sundown worship. It's attended with music again. Think about it. And it's attended with a small meal. Very small to begin the Sabbath. A larger meal for dinner, for the Sabbath hours, and song. And at the end, there's more music, but the music is a little bit different this time than it was in the beginning of the Sabbath hours. Because the music beginning of the Sabbath hours was so joyful and so upbeat, but now they begin to sing songs that had meaning, but they were different because they weren't just quite as light and joyous. You know why? Because the Sabbath hours were coming to an end and they were so sad. Oh, they didn't want them to come to an end. Oh. They weren't near as enthusiastic as the Sabbath hours closed out as when it began. Why? Because the Sabbath's closing. Oh, no. And a new week is beginning. And as this new week begins, it's crowding out my Sabbath. How many of us really think along that line? As the sun begins to set tonight, that new week's starting to crowd out what? The Sabbath hours. It's bringing them to a close. Oh, no. I still sing. I'm still happy, but it's not with all the enthusiasm because I had all 24 hours to enjoy it. One final prayer is made. One final song sung. And I don't know why it hit me, and I could be just dead wrong. But I said, you know, for those who so enjoyed it, it was almost like the loss of a loved one, a funeral. A final song sung. A final prayer made. You know why? Because you'll never be able to celebrate that Sabbath ever again in this life. It's gone for eternity. Never will you have that one to come back. It's gone. And so they had that final prayer, and they had that final song that they sang, because the Jews made the Sabbath a delight. At least they used to. That's a real delight. It's a joy. It was clear. It was family time. It was clear. It was a time for prayer. It was time for Bible study. It was a time for singing, Bible study, visiting the sick. And they didn't want to see that sun set. It had been too good a day. And they didn't want to see it set. Friend, how many of us today, how many of us really welcome it in that way and enjoy all of the hours instead of letting the world crowd it out in the afternoon and the wee hours? You see, follow me? Everybody will have that from time to time. There'll be a thought that may enter your mind, you know, during the Sabbath hours that shouldn't. Well, you know, the sun goes down, I got to do something. Rebuke that. Say, there's going to be plenty of time in a few hours right now. I don't want to crowd God out of my life in a special way. I want this time. I need this time. If it's just solitude and quiet and prayer and away from the world, don't bring the world in. Keep the world out on that day. And when you go to them, as it were, you go to them to give a prayer or a song or make a need the way Jesus would. And you say, boy, that's a little different than I thought they'd do. But next week we're going to answer the question, well, how about a New Testament Sabbath keeper? How does that really apply to us? What should we really do to be pleasing in the sight of heaven? I want us to pray about this week. I mean, really get down on our knees and pray about it. And remember, self will have to go. You can't have self out there and say, yeah, but I like to do this, and I like to visit this, and I like to be with these friends, and I like to be over here, and I want to go over here. Is that what we really need on the seventh-day Sabbath? The day that God created and blessed and sanctified, set it apart for holy use that He could spend time with you. You especially. And then for us to say, I'm too busy, or friends are more important, or mom and dad's more important. You know, you follow me. Let's really pray about this week. And let's see, as we study, as we come really to grips, that are we getting the most out of the day that God has made for us? Are we getting the most out of it? The most out of Him? Him getting the most out of us, rather than to be occupied with other things that have no place in the Sabbath hours. We'll study it more in depth and use more Bible, more spirit of prophecy as we go, but this is a good food for thought. I've come to the conclusion that God is very particular. He says He'd come back after a peculiar people. They dare to be different. They dare to treat one day different than they do the other, because it reminds them of God and the relationship that we all need. Will you with me this week? Will you pray about it? As I'm going to be praying too, that God will help us to understand it better. And not only understand it, because once you understand it, then you become what? Accountable. But some of you say, well, I'm not going to study it then. Well, you're already accountable then. Are you get it? We are accountable for what we have the opportunity, right, privilege to do. Think about it. Even if we decide not to, but you had the opportunity to do it and you don't do it, you're still accountable, and I am too. That puts it out on the line. May God help us to see the importance, all right, of God in a special day to be with His special people, that we may be pleasing and that we may be a blessing to someone else besides ourselves. May God help us. Let's kneel, shall we, as we pray. Merciful Father in heaven, thank You for Your word today. Thank You for reminding us of who You are and who we are. How desperately we need to understand what would be pleasing in Thy sight. Those things that would be a blessing, not only to You, but blessing to us. All these things that You've left for us, they are for us, to help us. To help us prepare for the new earth that You've created for us. You said, I'm coming back, I'm coming soon. Oh, how we need to be ready. There's no way that we can have a hand in the world and the hand on You. We must separate. We must put our both hands in the hand of our Creator, our loving Redeemer. You promised to save us. We put our hand to the plow. You said we can't take it away.